and this is 2020.
On the ABC News Magazine, 2020, tonight.
I don't care what you say anymore, this is my life.
Billy Joel.
Go ahead with your own life, leave me alone. Only the good times.
Says he was a punk in high school, didn't show up for class.
So at the end they said, well, we can't graduate you because you haven't showed up, so you have to go to summer school. So I went, I'm not going to Columbia University, I'm going to Columbia Records.
He did, and now at 30, he's grossed more than $80 million in records alone. Album after album, big sellers all, and each one in a different style. He's one of the very few truly unique performers in music today.
I just want someone.
An exclusive profile tonight by Tom Hoving, Billy Joel.
I want you just the way you are. I would not leave you in times of trouble.
Next, an exclusive profile of Billy Joel. A true original in a world of imitators.
I took the good times, I'll take the bad times, I'll take you just the way you are.
Now, you are about to see a man who has grossed $80 million with his music. He is Billy Joel. That is a superstar, who at the same time is a very private person. He's not been interviewed for television until Tom Hoving talked with him for this profile. Profile of Billy Joel. Tom.
You? A lot of people think Billy Joel is the best songwriter and performer in the United States today, but he's more. He's also one of the few classic balladeers we've got. And at 30, Billy Joel is still the uninhibited wise guy from Hicksville, Long Island.
I'd like to start the show off this evening by giving the Iranian salute.
One, two, three, four!
8 years ago, when Billy Joel first started out on the concert tour, he was glued to the piano. No more. Today, he's every bit as much a charged-up performer as he is singer. He's managed to make that cocky New York image of his appeal to just about everybody. But it's still his songs, they're classic songs now, that people come to hear.
Tell the waitress I'll come back to Zanzibar. I'll be hiding in the darkness with my beer. Whoa, she's laying out Shanty Town. She's gonna pull the curtains down for me. For me.
Today, at 30, Billy Joel has grossed more than $80 million in record sales alone. How did it all begin?
I think when I first knew I was going to be interested in music was when I learned my first piece in the John Thompson book. Everybody who's ever taken piano lessons has to take a John Thompson course. Book one, it's got a red cover, and the first piece you learn is Off We Go to Music Land. I said, Off We Go. Come with me and hold my hand. One of those things, and I learned it, and I was like, hey, all right. And after a while, I got bored playing classical music. I was just tired of it, and I had started developing an ear. So I just started writing music. That's when I think I really started writing. Instead of playing that was on the music, I would play, make up my own piece, but it had to be in the style of Beethoven. And my mother'd be in the kitchen cooking it. She'd go, "Hey, you're picking that one up pretty quick." I go, "Yeah, I like this piece. It's pretty easy." And then the next day, when it was time for me to practice again, I didn't remember what I played the day before, so I'd make up something else. And she'd go, "What's that?" I said, "Oh, that's the second movement." But
can you sit down now and play me some of that fake Beethoven concerto that you invented?
Oh, just anything, you know, you can go. And keep going with stuff like that. And
Hicksville, Long Island. When Billy Joe was 5 years old, his father walked out, and Billy was raised by his mother in what is still the largest tract housing development in the country. At Hicksville High School, Billy was not a dedicated student. He spent more time in local bands than he did in classrooms.
In school, I would just get these high marks all the time. I realized, okay, I got the system beat. So by the time I got to junior high, I was kind of like, eh, the heck with it. I started hanging around and getting in a lot of trouble. I was a punk. Cold beer, hot lights, my sweet romantic, she makes nice. When I got to the end of high school, I went all the way through 12th grade. I didn't quit, but I just hadn't showed up for school half the time. So at the end, they said, well, we can't graduate you because you haven't showed up, so you have to go to summer school. So I went, I'm not going to Columbia University. I'm going to Columbia Records.
Billy Joel would get to Columbia Records, but not right away. First, he teamed up with this man, Artie Ripp. Artie's a Los Angeles record producer who 10 years ago heard a demo tape and signed Billy Joel, sight unseen, to a long-term contract.
I love Billy Joel. I want to have Billy Joel on my record label. We pick up the phone. This is Artie Ripp.
Oh, the guy at the other end of the phone, I said, "Where is Billy now?" He says, "Billy's sleeping on the floor of a laundromat in Long Island right now."
I says, "You're kidding." He says, "Billy's broke, I'm broke, everybody's turned us down. We don't understand why nobody believes and appreciates Billy's genius. For 7 years we've been working on him, coming from the group The Hassles, and he was a star in that group, and so on. We don't understand." I said, "I'm glad nobody else understood it. I'm glad you finally wound up at the bottom with me. We'll go to the top together."
She's got a way about her, I don't know.
They did go to the top, Artie Ripp and Billy Joel, but not together. This is Cold Spring Harbor, the first album Artie Ripp produced for Billy Joel. You won't find it in most record stores. It was recorded at the wrong speed. Now, if you were a young songwriter getting into the music business and your producer made a mistake like that, you might do what Billy Joel did.
I realized after a while, wow, I really signed away a lot of stuff and I was getting ripped off. So how was I going to get all the things back that I signed away? Well, I'm going to sit these people out. I'm going to disappear off the face of the earth.
And disappear is just what Billy Joel did. Under the alias of Bill Martin, he took a job playing at a small piano bar in downtown Los Angeles. If you drive down Wilshire Boulevard, way downtown, you'll find it. It's called the Executive Room.
It's 9 o'clock on a Saturday. A regular crowd shuffles in. There's an old man sitting next to me.
It too would be the setting for a song. It's the kind of place where the regulars often forget to have dinner.
He says, "But can you play me a memory? I'm not really sure how it goes. But it sounded sweet, and I knew it complete when I wore a younger man's clothes."
Today, some of the regulars still remember the man who called himself Bill Martin.
And he was kind of like hiding out. And he needed something to tie him over for 6 or 8 months.
Played the old Sanders.
Let's face it, you know, he didn't think he'd be caught in a place like this.
Sing us the song, your
Angeles isn't really a bar town, so the people who went to this place were real bar people.
Now, Paul's a real estate novelist.
There was a guy who always wanted to be a novelist, but he was a real estate broker, and he was always talking about the novel he was going to write.
With Davey, who's still in the Navy.
There was a guy who would always bet on the horses and always lose and always come in. And it was always the guy who would come in, the real Hollywood type guy, with the, you know, Gucci stuff, and they'd bring his chick with him, and he'd try to be real, you know, hey, kid, and he'd rub my neck. What are you doing here? I can get you, you know, I can get you a recording contract. And I was like, nah, that's a dirty business. I want to stay here. I like what I'm doing. I think I put him in the song, too. But it's pretty much the way I put it down in the song. Because I knew when I was working, I said, I've got to get a song out of this.
And Billy Joel did get a song out of this bar. A very good song. He called it Piano Man. It virtually launched his career. But he didn't get something else he wanted out of here. And that was freedom. Freedom from the record company that had originally signed him, Family Productions. It would take almost a year for Billy Joel to come out of the piano bar and go into a recording studio. By 1974, he had moved back to New York and signed with Columbia Records. 2 years and two albums later, platinum finally came, The Stranger.
I had written a song first. And I listened to the song and I went, something's missing. Something's missing, The Stranger. There's got to be a theme to The Stranger. And I had this picture of this guy walking down a rainy street with a raincoat over, sort of a Humphrey Bogart kind of French sort of thing. And I wanted to write a theme like that, and I came...
The Stranger established Billy Joel's wide-ranging style. Visual songs written with a journalist's eye. Love songs that include a little twist of the knife. And of course, his own brand of good solid rock and roll. And from the very first bars, you know it's Billy Joel. The knife-like percussion opening of Stiletto. Big City blues sound of New York State of Mind. The energy and drive of My Life. Piano drum beat of Angry Young Man.
That's actually the it's not hard to do, it's just this. If you're a drummer, any drummer can do it, but people are like, wow, how'd you do that? And they try to do it with one hand. Okay, it's actually, it sounds like Eyewitness News. Roger Grimsby, here now the news. We wanted, every time I write one way, I write a song that's in one style, I want to totally, the next song I write, I want it totally different. Because I don't want to get bored, I want to keep myself interested.
I think there are a lot of better songwriters, technically, than he is.
Stephen Holden is a music critic who writes for the New York Times and Rolling Stone magazine.
And he embodies something that is unique and him, and that a lot of people respond to, because he's the boy next door who's a terrific piano player, a terrific party entertainer. He likes rock and roll. He's a fan of the 60s.
Where did you get the idea for the title, Glass Houses? It's been almost 15 years now since Billy didn't graduate from Hicksville High School. He's moved into a modern glass house on Long Island, a stone's throw from where he used to live.
I would throw a rock through that window.
His picture window is on the cover of his latest album, Glass Houses. It's a window made for looking out, not peering in. And the success of his albums has allowed Billy Joel to make his home life today just what he wants it to be, totally private.
Some have said the human heart.
Professionally, Billy's more open. He recorded Glass Houses at a studio in New York City with Phil Ramone, his producer since The Stranger.
You are such a prisoner of prizes.
Is that too poetic? Purple prosy?
No, not really. I think if you come out of it, all right. If he comes out.
And I am just a victim of
desire.
Here, with only minutes to go before actually recording, Billy's composing a line for a song he'll call Don't Ask Me Why. The Billy Joel sound now is not one that's easily pinned down. He can sound like Mick Jagger on one song, and then turn around and you'd swear it's Paul McCartney on another. But the songwriting is still very much Billy Joel's alone, even if it's finding a rhyme at the last minute.
Everybody's waiting for me to finish these songs. It's like squeezing a lemon. You don't have to get hung up in this. We can do the job.
No, that's due. You may be right.
Glass Houses is another departure for Billy Joel. He writes songs for the stage now, and he loves to perform.
Ho!
Where have you got it?
Hey at the end, ho in the beginning.
But right, give it to us, Mike. I got it somewhere in the middle.
To bash me out again. I was only having fun, wasn't hurting anyone, and we all enjoyed the weekend for a change. I've been stranded in the combat zone. I lost the Bedford style on me.
You May Be Right is now a hit single, and here Billy performs it for a television commercial.
Remember how I found you there, alone in your electric chair. I told you dirty jokes until you smiled. You were lonely for a man.
Billy Joel is the product of a close-knit team now. It's like a family business. His wife, Elizabeth, is also his manager, and his concerts are produced by a loyal group of musicians and technicians. It's a small, select group today. In fact, there's only one reminder of the early days. The man who first set Billy Joel's music to records and who still receives about 25 cents from every album sold.
They sell lots of records because he makes great music worldwide, and it just keeps coming in. I don't get the phone call 4 o'clock in the morning. The truck broke down. Somebody broke in my room. My heart is breaking. My girlfriend left me. I just get the check. You know?
In the past 8 years, Billy Joel has sold more than 12 million albums, won 4 Grammy Awards, grossed more than $80 million, and sells out every concert performance. Singer, piano player, songwriter, performer, a big shot.
I don't have any delusions about Billy Joel, rock star. You know, 2 years from now, maybe I won't be on top of the charts or whenever it is. And it's going to go down or up or down. And if you're off the charts for too long and you have a hit, it's called a comeback. You know, hey, I'm just not going to take it that seriously. I'll take my music seriously, but the star thing, what is a star? It's a ball of gas.